Hello and welcome everyone joining us today for another Augma Bone Cement Academy webinar focusing on how to optimize work with bone cements. My name is Elisheva and I'm the moderator for today's lecture. Today we have the privilege of hosting Dr. José Camelo Ferreira for a webinar that will shed light on his personal perspective through a variety of clinical cases. If you have any questions, you can send them using the Q&A button. And now I have the honor to introduce Dr. José Camelo Ferreira. Dr. Ferreira is an oral surgeon living and working in Algarve, Portugal. He is a member of the Portuguese Dentistry Order, the OMD, and he is a national and international speaker for Noble Biocare since 2011. Dr. Ferreira graduated with a BDS DDS from ISCS Sul in Portugal in 1998. And afterwards studied prosthodontics in Madrid. In 2014, he became an associate fellow of the Foundation for Oral Rehabilitation. Dr. Ferreira then went on to study advanced implantology and hard and soft tissue management at Implant Brazil, São Paulo in 2015, where he continued to study zygomatic implant surgery and rehabilitation until 2020. In 2017, he received an oral surgery specialist degree from the OMD. Since 2017, Dr. Ferreira has been the Portuguese head leader of the SmileTube TV, which offers online and practical courses all over Europe and in the US. In 2019, Dr. Ferreira received the title of Surgical Master in Regenerative Implant Dentistry from the University of Szeged, Hungary, in Hungary, under Professor István Urban. And he is currently an assistant professor in various courses on advanced oral surgery in Portugal and Brazil. Dr. Ferreira, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much, Sheila. Well, it's a pleasure to be here with you, all of the guys and girls that decided to stay an hour away from their families to see this guy. And I decided to, when they invited me to show some cases, I decided to do it in a way similar to my experience with the material. So since the day I first discovered the material until today. So my idea is to give back to you the experience I had and the road that I went without my bon appetite until nowadays. So it got everything to do with the phrase that I put from Prost, that the real voyage of discovery consists not only in seeing new sights, but in looking with new eyes. And that's exactly what happened to me. So first, I want to say that I'm not receiving any specific honorarium for this lecture, okay? The opinions here might be wrong, might be right, but they are mine and resulting from my clinical experience. And my clinical image, they were not being falsified or mixed in a way to disguise or to change outcomes of the surgeries. And also, I would like to add that all the material, most of the material that I use is from Augma, Noble Biocare, which is the implants I use and all the abutments, etc., and the prostheses. Ora A, which is a product that I'm really in love with, as with Augma, and all the sutures, everything, it's from B. Brown, which is, I don't know there, but in Portugal, I think I tried a lot of them and I think they are the best and less expensive. So let's start here. You can see me with my friend Amos. It's exactly the day that I've met him. We're much younger and prettier then. in the bottom, you can see Dr. Salvoni, Professor Salvoni, Alexander Salvoni, and Professor Salama, that Salvoni invited me to go to the Dental XP in Miami to speak with him in Salem about a possible hands-on course of zygomatic surgery in one of the dental XP symposiums. My kids in the top, they are spending all my money in the bar because they didn't knew better. So it was a dramatic situation when they put me the bill. And so Salama invited me to, when I arrived in the morning, Salvoni was not there yet. So he invited me if I wanted to see something. And there were two presentations going on. One was, I don't remember, and the other one was Amos presenting the bone augmentation. So he told me, do you want to see bone appetite augmentation presentation? I said, well, yeah. He's offered me to go inside, so I would not tell, no, I don't like. So I went without knowing anything about it. And so Amos presented to me. It was a very simple lecture he gave, a very good one also. He's a very good communicator. And so I took knowledge of the syringe, which is for me the best syringe in the world in this kind of material. And I used some of them, so it's perfect. And it shows the quality that they want to give to their material, because they could use a cheaper syringe, one that breaks or whatever. Comes already with the serum and with the calcium sulfate. If I do any mistakes, I'm sorry, because this is the third webinar I give today. And so I gave one in the morning in Portuguese. Now, a few hours ago, I've given it in Spanish, and now I'm giving it in English. So if I say something in Spanish, or you have to forgive me, my friends, you have to forgive me. So this is the syringe. And then he talked about, you know, simple grafting. And I decided to begin for the simplest one, which was the extraction. So you take out the tooth, you have the socket, then you put the liquid, the serum, into the blue mark. And here we go, pressing gently until it arrives to the blue mark. And then you take out the cover. There's always a bit of powder coming out, don't worry. And then you put it immediately in the socket, and you press it for 3 seconds, and that's it. Of course, some of that comes out, don't worry, just clean it on the outside, don't mess around in the inside, you don't need to mess it around or to pressure it, it's done. You just need to cover it with a collagen buffer or plug or whatever you want to call them. And because it's what you do in all the grafts. When I use the xenograft, you know, it's hydroxyapatite bovine hydroxyapatite. It's the same. You have to cover it because you don't want saliva to make it come out and or fruit go in or whatever. You want to give some time for the gum to heal. So then you suture it in a way that it doesn't come out. And at the end, you can use the wound protection or wound dressing from Oreid, which is one of the spectacular things I discovered since I start working with Augma, through Augma, of course. And I'm using it for everything. I don't have the photos, but I just the other day I had a sinus lip, a patient with a sinus lip, and then he went like 3 or 4 days and he sneezed and he made like this a couple of times. And one of the times it just blew up in the mouth. And then he was afraid to come, and then he came like 3 days after, and it was a hole inside the sinus. So I was like, oh my God, get me a diaper. And then I remember to close it with the Oreid, and the patient came every day to put the new Oreid, and she was behaving really good this time. And the fact is, in 3 weeks, it was closed, and it was a miracle. I have the photos from the surgery, but I was so scared that I don't have the photos from the treatment, because I don't think it's a time to pick up the camera and take pictures. This you can see the x-ray with the normal look of the bone cement. And then, so in the Augma webinar, presentation from Amos, I discovered there were two products, different products. In Portugal, we don't have the first one, the 3D, but it's only calcium sulfate, biphasic, and then you can use it in small defects like the one we saw before, and because it doesn't give you volume, it's totally absorbed because it only has calcium sulfate. It's very good for soft tissue augmentation, which we'll see in the next presentations of surgeries. And it was taught to me by a friend, which is called Michael Ketzer, and we'll talk about it later. The second one, which is the one I use and I really like, it's one of the things I like more nowadays. That's why I'm doing this webinar. And it's used for small and large defects, horizontal bone augmentation, and also for me, soft tissue augmentations. And it keeps the volume because it has pieces of hydroxyapatite and helps to slow the process of absorption of the calcium sulfate. So the thing that caught my attention better was Amos telling me that we didn't need all the things that we learn doing bone augmentation, you know, like large flaps, extensive detachments, and the surgery takes hours, and the patient is nervous, and then you have to, the patient has to be there, and you pop, 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 pop. Now you're putting fixation pins, and the head goes like this, and then it escapes inside of the flap. It's a nightmare sometimes. So it's complicated. Also, the post-operative, it's complicated. Then you have to do a suture without tension. That takes some time. You have to cut the periosteum. You know, you can cut the dentary nerve, whatever. It's if you don't have to do it, it's better. I saw it, but it was too good to be true, honestly. So I went home and study about calcium sulfate. And I discovered that it was not new. The Egyptians used to use them for the mummies, to conserve the mummies. They put it in the bandages. And in the 12th century already, there was some anatomists using the material to conserve the body parts they were studying. And then you can see that in 1944, Nielsen was the first one to report, the first one was in 1892, but more seriously was Nielsen treating 16 patients with bone defects infected and 14 with no infected, with the same result, which is because it's a salt, doesn't get infected, and it's even good to kill bacteria. So, but the first truly true study was in 1955 by Petlier and Lillo, which they were researchers, and they made an article about the treatment of cylinders made of the material, and they had made a critical size bone cavities. With critical size, it means that they cannot cure by themselves, and the authors concluded that the bone repaired after 3 months were total. So then I went for the biological properties. I didn't want something to create, you know, inflammatory response, anything like that. So all the articles said that it was minimal inflammatory response to the calcium sulfate. And the absorption was complete, so doesn't leave any material left. So even in the cases that it could not work, you won't have anything there to bother you in the future. So other thing that I liked it was the gingival fibroblasts that seem to grow faster in the situations where you use the calcium sulfate as a barrier, as a let's call it a membrane, in relation to other materials like PTFE, etc. And so they arrived to the conclusion that it was ideal for a second intention healing. So then, I forgot to change the title here. It's regenerative properties. So it is completely absorbed and the bone grows faster in the bone cavities than in the control areas. This was in 1961. Also, more actual studies say that there's a greater expression of bone morphogenic proteins as well as growing factors in the bone defects where you use the calcium sulfate. The local increase of concentration of calcium ions can affect the genesis and function of osteoblasts, stimulating to their differentiation. And still the absorption of the calcium sulfate makes creation of calcium phosphate that will guide the construction of the bone. So you have also about the, we talked it already, but it's the barrier effect, the membrane effect. And so it was very, very effective. And the studies show that it is in Spanish, but I can tell you that it says that it avoid the growing of soft tissue inside the cavities, giving possibility to the bone new formation. I'm sorry about this, you know, I hate in the webinars, this part of the articles, but I think it's important because it's how I don't believe the first time you tell me something, I have to see it, and I have to discover it. You know, the Portuguese are like this. That's why we went and through the sea without knowing anything, and we arrived to the American continent. It's because we had to see. And so I had to study about it, and I had to pass it to you in a quick way. It's only one more minute. And so I like very much this this chart. It's in Spanish also, but I think this way is more truly. So you can see that the main things about comparison all the bone grafts, and you can see that none of them, it's homeostatic except the calcium sulfate, and angiogenic also, it's very strong in that. And as a barrier, no other graft will do a barrier effect like calcium sulfate, and also the liberation of growing factors provoked by its presence. And you can see here that a study with a comparison of from 2004 with a calcium sulfate and a bovine xenograft, and they arrived to the conclusion that both groups grow bone three-dimensionally, but the calcium sulfate has 62% of bone, while the xenograft has 26% in the histological samples. So here is a study developed by Dr. Amos, and you can see that there's a bone sample with 3 months after the bone grafting, and you can see that 10% of the area, it's the only thing that remains without being bone, and it's surrounded by connective tissue that then, after a little while, will disappear also, making bone also. So, and there's another article, this article is very good, I advise you to read it. It's in Spanish, but maybe there is in English also, that it says that the fluids of the body form calcium phosphate in a way that will create a conductive net to the biological stimulation and growing of the bone in the defect. So my conclusions were, you know, and I was a bit jet-lagged, so, but it was anyway, they were calcium sulfate is biocompatible, it's osteoconductive, and it's not osteoinductive. I'm sorry, I forgot to take it out. It was a mistake of mine, and safe. It's not osteoinductive, but it is in a way because it's osteostimulating, which makes the bone grow and releasing the growth factors in its presence and because of calcium phosphate. It has no toxicity and is angiogenic, hemostatic, and it works very well as a barrier. And this is also something that I really like. It can be combined with other types of grafts, autografts, whatever you use, because it doesn't, it works anyway. And in my clinical opinion, it's even augment the effect of the other grafts. Actually, I don't believe you'll need to join any graft at all to the Augma, but you can do it as a study in the university, So this is beginning of my surgical journey with Augma. So I went the next day, I went down, spoke with Amos, and I told him, so what? How can I buy it? Can I buy it in Portugal? He said, no, not yet. So you have to take it with you. He made me like a price, 18 syringes. And so I put it in my trunk. And I had to bring it back to Portugal, you know, like 18 syringe full of white powder in the bag, and I was really afraid that they will stop me in the customs, and they will ask me what is this, and I said, well, it's bone graft, and yeah, at least one or two they will open, and probably they will confiscate the whole thing. And probably I will end up in Guantanamo or something like that. So I was really scared. But I brought it and it was good because nobody caught me and I started to use it. So this was actually the first case where I used it. And it was a very young lady. She's very, very beautiful. And she's German, but she's not rich. Normally the Germans, we have the idea they are rich, but this one is like a hippie, a bit of a hippie. So she's not rich. And she went to my office with pain in the front teeth and she was wearing a removable plate. She had a lot of kids already. And I told her, if you don't have too much money, I can, you know, I explained the situation. The abscess, the cyst on the 22, and while we had it, we could also put the 24, and she will stop using the removable plate. So I told she had no money, so I told her you pay me the implants, and I'll do the bone graft for free because I have a new material that I want to test. And if you promise not to put me in court, I will test it on you if you don't mind. And I say, yeah, go ahead. And so this is the initial CBCT. You can see the major horizontal defect in the 24. I know it's not your way of calling the teeth. I don't know if you use these numbers, but we use the first quadrant, the second quadrant. The first is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So you call it 11. And the second quadrant, you call it 21, 22, 23, and so on. So it's the cyst and mobility on the tooth 22 and the horizontal bone loss in the 24. You can see it here in the intraoral photography, that it's very, very, with a great expression. So here it's the surgical planning. And you can see that I really tested the implants. I had no space. And in the 22, I had a bit of space, but the cyst occupy almost all the space. So I decided not to put the implants. And I explained to her that we were just doing the bone graft and taking some pictures. So this is the intraoral occlusion photography. And then I open it and I started doing the first implant on the opposite that I had planned. And so you can see in the bottom photography of the left that the implant, it's almost flying. So it only has a bit of the implant in the apex and a bit of cortical on the platform of the implant. I use the active Noble BioCare, which they cut like hell, so I love them and I do everything with them. So in this case, you can see also the premolar implant with no buccal bone. And I still decided to put it as long as I'm going to put the front one, why do not put the back one? And so this is the image. I left the healing abutment on the front one to keep the volume. It's something I do. I think it works. And to facilitate the access in the future. So I put the bone appetite. This is the first time. I press it 3 seconds with a gauze, with a dry gauze. And this is the aspect that it was. I didn't know how it will look. It's the first time. So I thought, well, maybe I'm a bit, looks like a mess. Well, let's try to close it. So I was told me not to mess around with it. So I just close it. And the good thing he told me, the good thing is I didn't have to cut the periosteum to pull the tissues. I just pull it very, very, with a big tension, with a great tension. And I could left it like 1 millimeter open, because you can left it until 3 millimeters without having major problems or any problem at all. So you can see still the material to the suture, and that was it. This is a new vision of it. And you have the removable plate also, the one she used to use. And here it's 5 months post-op, and you can see the gain of bone in the implant. I'm hearing some sounds. Hello. I'm hearing some sounds there. Someone has a microphone on. Okay. So 5 months post-op in the 24, you can see that if someone show me, I will say this guy doesn't know how to put an implant, because you can see it's too palatinized for the amount of bone we had. But it was not like that in the beginning. So. And then you can see the CBCT on the 22 with healing abutment, and it's also a lot of bone. So I decide to compare them, and here you can see that in the 22 we had not only the gap of the cyst disappeared, but we have 2.2 millimeters between the buccal and the palatal bone. And it was great, and I even have bone around the beginning of the healing abutment. And you can see here, and this is, for me, it's impressive. It was impressive. It was mind-blowing to see 3.8 millimeters in a place where you put the implant, which takes bone away, cells, osteoblasts, etc. And still, they managed to grow over the implants and create this amazing amount of bone. So you can see the before and after, which is impressive. And then 6 months after, I start the exposure of the implants. I just cut it like with a scalpel, just a little bit, like 2 millimeters. And then I try to do everything to it. And here it's the healing abutments already, a bigger one in the front one, and a healing abutment on the premolar. So we started the rehabilitation, and she was wearing anyway the removable plate because she didn't have any money to do a a temporary prosthesis, a fixed one. So we choose the color. It's a novel porcera. And then we have the pre-crowns gengiva aspect. You see almost covering, which is good for me because I wanted the more gum possible, the more soft tissue possible. Here you have the final crowns. And this is the immediate placement aspect, which I was not very happy because you could see the zirconia abutment on the 24, but I was hoping that it will disappear because the tissue always grows a bit when the everything is done well. So it's the occlusional aspect, and 2.5 years after the surgery, you can see the aspect from occlusal, which is impressive, the amount of bone you get in the 24 horizontally. You almost cannot identify the defect. And this is the final aspect of the crowns seen from the buccal side, which is much better than the natural teeth she had. And she's very happy. She's so happy that she's pregnant again. So then we had almost at the same time when we started, when we ended this case, we had like we had a course in my clinic that we do every year. This year, no, because of the COVID, but we do every year. So it's a zygomatic implant course. And we decided to use the bone cement. It was one way of testing it also, because we always want to fix the zygoma implants because they are so long and they have movements when you chew on them. And sometimes it's not bad if you only have zygomatic implants, but the other ones might lose bone because of the movement of the zygomatic ones. So I don't want to bother you with zygomatic surgery, because it's not something you do every day, but it's just because it was very important to me to find the difference. And this zygomatic surgeries show me the real truth about bone cement. So this was the mother of one of my lab technicians, and she's a very nice lady. We convinced her to do the surgery in the course because it was free for her. And so we studied, I made the planning for the surgery. You can see there's very little bone. And I decided to put 4 little implants on the front and 2 zygomatics. And then if possible, 2 retromolars implants. So this is the planning. You can see the way of the zygomatic implants. I don't like to go through the sinus with the zygomatic implants. I think it's like a prehistorical procedure, but of course I'm not the best one doing it. I believe you have to go outside to avoid complications in the future, and exactly those complications that give a bad name to the zygomatic implants and make people say it's only temporary. They work like any other implants. I know colleagues that do bridges on normal implants with the zygomatic implants. So this is a mix between the natural photo and the planning in a way that you can see the exact position in relation with the palate. And this is the pre-surgery photo, and then I'll show you a little film with the surgery. I hope you liked it.
Year after year, though every dream of a pony,
we always start in one side.
The cake was lit, and as you blew the candles out,
your heart refilled, and then we go to the other side. Your because if you do killed, both sides at the same time, the anesthetic goes away before you start from the next. We always start for the difficult part, which is the
zygomatics. But I am the answer to all your prayers.
You know, so the implant,
interesting agents have been eavesdropping.
When will you You will see also the delicacy, how I say, to do the Augma out of the cheek, you know, in a little moment. You will see the detail, the surgical detail.
The weather changed, the sky went black, and then
this is the second. Morris Beer, which is the best one in the world. You know, this is the second diplomatic.
And this may not be the item you selected,
and
but
the I am I like them to pick with my hands with a surgical driver to feel all the grief they got. That's why I always put the implants well distributed and parallel because it's my job.
Just yet. You'll be remembered
for your resistance,
and this is the thanks
you get. A really good part in all of them.
You want it tall, I came in under 5'4",
we have done
you
all
the dark.
Retromolar.
I do the sunburn a lot, as for handsome, well, can't help you there, so make a note.
What? I use this impression box to of open tray just to switch it. Now we're taking the
Augma
in the hope to stabilize the bit of time around the
inside.
The second, we have it. And then we push it. 2 seconds. And then we put some sticky bomb because it was a part and we wanted to show the students how to do sticky bomb. And then, as we do sticky bomb, we have a lot of glass, so we've done the PRF to cover it to show also how you can do the PRF. With the impression copy to gain some space in the tissues, and this is the final aspect. So after the surgery, she went to another room and we made the immediate load. I always like to do immediate load if possible. I don't do it if I don't have the torque enough, but if I have the torque, I always do it. I like to do it that way, and I believe firmly that it helps the osteointegration. Of course, sometimes with some implants, maybe you cannot do it, but with the experience I have with a Thai Unite from Noble, I always can do it, and it works very good. So this is the aspect. Here it's the final rehabilitation after 6 months. And you can see that despite being zygomatic implants, they don't come out in the middle of the palate. They are even better than the other ones. So they are comfortable for the patient. And this is the final zirconia ceramic Noble Procera bridge. And here it is in the mouth. And you can see after the surgery, a couple of months, or I don't know, 3 months, the different aspect of the same cut in the planning and then in the reality, which gave us like a vision of the bone over the zygomatic implant and the fear in the spine that one day we had to take it out for some reason. And I hope that never happens before I get retired. So here you can see a video with the planning and a video with the bone augmentation. You almost cannot see the implants. It was amazing. You see it here. So this is the final aspect. And she was very, very happy. And this is the second one. I think we have done it probably in the same day or next day. It's and we decided to do it in a different way from the other one. We decided, well, this is very good, but we won't know if the Augma is giving the effect or the sticky bone or whatever it's giving the effect. So let's try to do Augma on one side and the sticky bone and PRF on the other side to see the difference, because it's a course, you know. And by the way, this has some pictures of the place where I live in Algarve. It's this is one of the beaches you have here, and I think it's one of the most beautiful in the world. So you can see here the CBCT film with all the bone that there isn't any bone, and it's impossible to do implants. Probably only in the base of the skull. You can see now it's coming on the front and there's no bone whatsoever. So this is a young woman with 46 or 47 years old, and she's using the removable plate for as long as she can remember. She didn't want to talk about the reason, but it's something really traumatic, and she was every place she went, everybody told her then it was impossible to do fixed rehabilitation. And so she went to Dr. Lucio Faria, which is one of the main guys from the course. It's Dr. Lucio, Professor Alexander Salvori, and Professor Eugenio Pereira. And the four of us, we do the course, but under the supervision of Professor Salvoni, but Lucio had met this patient and he decided to bring her to do it on the course. So here it is, the planning with the quadzigoma, and it was not a very small zygoma, but not a very big one also. And so here we have the planning with the films. I always do it before the zygomatic surgeries to evaluate the amount of bone we'll have and the very difficult retromolars that we are thinking to do if it was possible, especially the one in the right side, which had some teeth there to occupy all the bone. So then we start the surgery. We open one quadrant because of the anesthetic, we do one quadrant, then we go to the other one, we do anesthetic, go to the other one, and then we close both at the same time to measure the parallelism between the implants. So this is the Norris drill. Again, it's amazing. We do the preparation, we do the drilling for the first implant. I don't like, as I told you, to go through the Schneider membrane. I don't see the need of it, and it's like you go through it accidentally, but it's like in a sinus lift. It's possible to do it without it. Sometimes could happen, but it's like it happens not a lot of times. So you can see that there's a window to make like a sinus lift for the implant. This is the first implant, the second one preparing. Then you have the two implants and the Schneider membrane is still intact, which is good because you don't want, you know, the things from nose coming out of your mouth and infection, and people come, oh, it smells so bad and it's so bad. And also, if you don't blow up the membrane, you can even gain some bone inside, like in the sinus lift when you do the bone grafting. Here it's the left side. So we started with the first implant and then we went to the second, and it was too near the cortical and it blowed, and there was an accident, like happens in some surgeries, it's our life. So we decided to put the third zygomatic implant And you can see that the eye, it's on the Minnesota, over the Minnesota, it's the eye. So we managed to do the hole. You can see here the three holes. It was like three zygomatic surgery on one side. And we managed to put the implants. You can see the implants coming out on the other side of the, almost on the cheek. And then we reconstruct the zygoma with sticky bone, because we decided that was very good to transport there and put it almost in the exact size. And also we used the Augma bone appetite on the other side, because we wanted to try to stabilize the implants instead of having movements and possible failure in the future. So this is a beautiful image of the bone appetite over the two implants. And we can see in the second quadrant, we only used sticky bone and PRF. So we did the suture. 1 week later, it looks like this. This is the old removable plate she had to use. You have to imagine how you will feel with this in your mouth for more than 20 years. And she had to use it again for a while, because we are not doing immediate load on the accident implant. And so, because we didn't have any option in the future if it failed. So Lucia made a temporary new plate after a while. And then we had also the finalization of the work by Lucia Faria. So the girl works in a radiographic center. She sent us a CBCT with a case with the bone growing on one side and not in the other. So I asked her to come to the clinic, or Lucio asked her to come to the clinic, and we made a CBCT, and it was unbelievable. You can see the bone growing vertically over the implants, and on the other side you have a little bone, of course, but the density, it's very little. You can see there a little of bone, and you can see here in the cuts that it goes over the implants, maybe, you know, a couple of millimeters. You see it now in the top, you see it, and on the other side, of course, the space is bigger, but I'm sure if we use the bone appetite, it will be the same result. So I was very happy with the result. And that's when by coincidence, it was the symposium of, you see the final result, and we changed the girl's life. So here, I knew about the International Symposium of Augma. So I spoke with Lucio and one more friend, and I told her we have to go because we have to see more cases and more colleagues doing different things with it. And so we decided to come from Algarve to Tel Aviv. We spent 1 day in the symposium and then three amazing days with some colleagues and with the guys from Augma, and it was beautiful. Here it's, I am in the Dead Sea, you know. It was a very, very good ending for the symposium. So then I came back full of blood in my gills, and I wanted to try the new things I've learned that some colleagues were doing. And so I decided to test the material in a big cyst, because if the material avoid the infection, it will be the ideal material to do a grafting on a post cyst removal surgery. So here it's the defect. It's it was sent to me by a colleague, by a doctor that sent it to me to take out the teeth and put the implants. And I was a bit afraid of that, because if you took the teeth from there, probably you won't be able to put nothing there, and the statical result was problematic, and it will be very difficult to do it statically again. So this is the view from the mouth with the fistula. And you can see it here with the CBCT. And this is the CBCT with a hole. And you can see it's very big and it caused an absorption of the roots. And the 21 was still without any root canal and it had it was the cause of the problem. And so I decided to go ahead and do the surgery. I tried not to do any lateral releases because I wanted to keep the tension over the future Augma bone graft. So here is the cyst. You can see the cyst, it's big. I didn't blow it up, but still it's infected. So I did the root canal at the same time. I close it and then I put some MTA to close the apex, and I put the bone appetite. Here is the look of it after the bone appetite. You see it coming on the defect near the root. And then the final suture. So here you can see 2 weeks post-op. You can see the CBCT image. And here you can see 6 weeks. I was a bit worried about the retraction of the gum in the 22 because I tried to cut it the more far from the teeth possible, but it, of course I cannot cut it in the lip or over the defect. So I still have to do the suture and made a little of tension in the cervical of the tooth. So I was a bit afraid, but after a while you'll see that it's gone. So this is the aspect 6 weeks after, and this is the aspect 3 months after, and you can see that the gum is recovering. It looks very nice. You can see the scar, but no problems there. So you can see here the graft after 3 months, and you can see a little spike there in the top, which is the bone that went inside the fistula. So then we also saw a friend of mine, now is a friend, I think it's a good friend. It's Michael Katzel from the States, showing how we would increase soft tissue with bone appetite, or in this case with 3D bond, which I don't have in Portugal yet, but I have the bone appetite. So I use the bone appetite instead with the same results. And you can see the image of the most occidental part of Europe. It's after this, it's the Azores, which is in the middle of the way, and then the United States. So here you can see the patient that has a peri-implantitis in the central implant, and the rest is very big. It is not also keeping a good hygiene, as you can see. But the implant was not so good either, and probably a very, very low quality implant. And it was bad from the start. So I had to take the implant out, and the teeth. He's a father of a very well-known football player in Europe. Everybody in Europe know it. And so this is the CBCT scan before surgery. And you can see there's a large defect in the buccal side and in the lingual side. You see it here, the planning. And here you can see the aspect of the x-ray and the planning. And I was planning a bridge with 2 implants and to put only 3 teeth, because I think it will be more aesthetical and nobody will notice. The problem is the keratinized tissue. So I decided to go ahead with a conventional bone augmentation. It's what I normally do, or used to do. In some cases I've changed it. So you have the aspect after removal of the crown. The crown was beautiful, as you can see, and implant position also. And so then you see the implant. I tried to remove it with a retrieval, and it broke And it was one of those days. And so I tried to take the implant with a trephine drill, and I managed to do it. It was unfortunately because I wanted to save the most of the bone as I could, because I have planned to put the implants. Was like 50-50. And then I decided no, because with the trephine, I still took more bone. So you can see here the defect, and you can see the collagen membrane and fixed on the buccal side, and then the xenograft from Noble BioCare, and then the closure of the membrane. In the Spanish webinar, someone asked me what was the name of the pins. I used Meisinger pins, which I think they are the best ones, because you can use them even in the toughest cortical, and they go in. They are beautiful. And you see the look of the finished closed membrane and the bone, and then you have to see the result of stretching all the soft tissues, because you have to cover it. And that's the big difference between Augma and this. You have to close the wound with no tension whatsoever, because it opens and you lose everything. And so you have to almost put the lip over the wound to close the flap. And you can see that this is normal, so you know it already, but then you have to resolve it in the future. So one problem at a time. So I closed it. I had prepared the temporary prosthesis to put the implants and to serve as a guide. So I closed the holes and I fixed it laterally. It's one of the nightmares. It comes every 15 days to glue it again. And for 6 months, it was like that. So after 6 months, we took a dental scan, a CBCT scan, and it was like this. It was amazing also. So I started to do the planning and to do the implants. He was anxious because he wanted something more fixed, and because it always comes out on Saturdays and on Christmas and every in the middle of the wedding or something. So he came, and of course everything was looking good, but the soft tissue was not looking so good. So I had to go and catch some from the palate, or do difficult soft tissue surgeries to gain some volume. And this is the look of the xenograft when it is a success. You can see the little bits of hydroxyapatite all over, but it's bleeding, it's good, it's almost alive. And you can put the implants there and it works. Normally you should not do immediate load on the bone graft place with this kind of graft, but because I have bone on the apex, I could do it. So I did the implants, I put the temporary prosthesis, and here it is, the implants done in the way I wanted. And now we have the problem. Like this, it was the good for me. It was good for me if the tissue could stay like this. So I thought, well, let's see if Michael it's right. And then I pick up the abutments and I did the temporary bridge. I'm the one that did my temporary rehabilitations. I do the adaptation. And here is the use of Augma bond apatite over it. And it was like this. I pressed the syringe, 3 seconds. And this was the aspect. So I just took out the bits outside and I tried to close the wound as with more tension as I could, with the tension that I could. And it was like this after the pressing, and it was like this after the flap was closed. I give some stitches just to stabilize the flap. I didn't want it to open and close and lose all the things. So I stabilize it and I put the healing abutments for the material not to enter inside the implants. So here you have a Oral Aid wound dressing that I put over it. And then I, because it's a sticker, so it sticks. But I decided also to put the temporary prosthesis over it and fix it directly with the orate in the implants to fix the, to have a secondary fixation of the wound dressing. So you can see 2 weeks after and 3 weeks after, you can see the line of the keratinized tissue before Augma and after Augma. Of course, if I had a tree bond, I will use it instead of the bond apatite because I didn't want to have little bits of the hydroxyapatite in the gum. But that happens to me also with the other xenograft materials, you know, with the hydroxyapatite, and it doesn't kill me. It's, I don't really think it's important. It's going to be absorbed. So here it's the difference before and after, and you can see the difference between both of them here, and it's, for me, it's amazing. I was like head over heels. I phoned Lucio, hey Lucio, you have to see this case. Michael was right, and so we start to do this kind of cases like maniacs, and with spectacular results. I hope one day to show you, and it's beautiful, it's beautiful. So 3 months after, you can see the gum, it's almost clean, doesn't have any little bits of hydroxyapatite, and you can see the coping impression, and with closed tray, and I don't have the, I still in the middle of the case, but you can see the planning of the tooth shape for the three teeth, and they're going to look very good. And if it was like a princess, I can do a bit of bone grafting, soft tissue grafting on the middle tooth to create some volume, but I don't believe you will want to suffer for that because he's a, you know, he's a 60-year-old man that is already very happy with a situation like it is. So as we're talking about soft tissues, I decided to show you also a case. This is the beach in front of my house. It's the one I go with my family. And I think it's very nice. And so I decided to show you. This case is also a soft tissue case, very different from the other one, but it was also an experience that I think it went good. And I'm hoping to see the end of it in a couple of months. So you can see this was a treatment, orthodontic treatment that was done in a iatrogenic way. And so the girl, it's a young girl from Brazil that she came here, and she's very beautiful. And she wanted me to cover the tooth with the gum. You see, oh, I have this, I don't like it. Can you put some gum over it? I said, yeah. No, we have to take it out, because the apex is coming out already. So it's amazing how the tooth is still there. So my planning was, I'm going to take it out and then we'll wait for 1 month and a half, 2 months until the soft tissue heals. And then we can go from there to another type of grafting, bone grafting, whatever. First, I wanted to have the tissue to be able to cover anything that I will do in the future. And so I decided to take the tooth out, and I saw that there was a little bone in the socket. So I thought, well, maybe I can use Augma here because I got nothing to lose. I'm not doing anything anyway. So I decided to put some Augma over it, like, and brush it again, and then I take only the outside layer of the Augma and I put some orate, and I decide to, you know, suture the orate, and because you can do, you know, like horizontal mattress, modified horizontal mattress sutures to, I decided to do, I sometimes do it like this. I decide to, you know, suture the edges of the wound dressing. And I sutured to the ferula that was on the lingual side. So this is 1 week later. You know, I told her not to wash that part of the mouth. She didn't. And you can see the absorption of the dissolvents of the calcium sulfate and the remaining of the different sizes of the hydroxyapatite. So this is 1 week. You can see still the bottom stitches, and you can see that the healing was amazing without losing any of the volume, which was my biggest fear. So, and this is 3 weeks after. You can still see a bit of hydroxyapatite coming out, but it looks amazing, amazing. So, she came 1 week after to put the natural teeth attached to the fairway she had from the orthodontic. And here it's the aspect, and she's already very happy. I told her I needed a photo for the webinar, and she told me she couldn't come. I think she's very happy. It is lucky if she come back to do the rest, because until it falls out, she's happy and doesn't spend any money. So, and this, it's for me a more serious case, and this is like the final point in my, it's the final point in my, you know, my look over the bone cement, Augma bon appetit. And it's the, like the crown or the sherry over the cake. And that's why I choose it. You can see that he's a guy, he came because he had some pain and movement in the teeth, and he wanted to have a fixed prosthesis, and everything was infected. The bone was full of holes. It looked like a, you know, Emmental Swiss cheese. And when I looked, the CBCT was even worse. So even in the lingual side, everything was ruined. And I had like two places to put some implants. And so this is the intro photograph. You can see the guy was, he had a bit of careful washing it, but the calculus, he didn't took it out. And so I told him it was impossible and irresponsible, not impossible, irresponsible. And he's a young guy, he's like 40 years old. So we should do it in the right way. Instead of gaining 4 months, we were losing all his life. So I convinced him to put two implants in the good parts and two locators, and then wait for some months to put the rest of it over the bone, the Augma bone graft. So I did the extractions, the opening of the flap. I cut a bit of bone that was coming out to make it a bit more harmonious. And then I decided to put the implants, parallel implants, because if not, the locators won't work. And here you can see the defects in the front of the implants because they were put in the canine positions. And you can see here, you can even see the spiral of the implants. And then I put the my best friend now in the surgery, which is bone cement from Augma, and I put it over it like if it was snowing. And you can see here the defect and then the bone over it and the implant. And I just close it, and I was afraid because the prosthesis could break the material and the movement, you see. And I was a bit concerned of it, so I was expecting to see the result. He went home, he was, well, as happy as he can be with a locator removable prosthesis. So the 1 week, the healing is amazing with Augma. That's one thing, I cannot prove it because, you know, each people have his own healing time, but it is amazing in almost all the cases. So you can see 1 month, and of course he opened a bit you can see that the stitches, because of the removable plate, they open a little bit and create that shape of a valley in the healing. And you can see it 3 months after. And I took a CBCT scan, and I told him, well, if the guys from Augma are right, now we can put the implant in 4 months, after 4 months. And he said, no, doctor, I cannot take it anymore. I want it. Blah, 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 blah. And so I decided to do it in 3 months. And I was a bit scared, but I opened it. And with the, of course, the incision, you will see it's not so big as the first one because I didn't need it. I only opened what I need. So I didn't need to see the defects. And here you can see the result after 3 months. And I have the dates in my photos if someone, because I was afraid nobody will believe me. And I have the photos with the dates. You can go to the, you know, the Mac photography, whatever. And there's the dates there. So if one day you want to see them, the first surgery and the 3 months after, you can see an amazing healing of bone. And the thing that I like more, and you can compare it with the other surgery, with the xenograft, you don't see the little, you know, the little parts of the hydroxyapatite. That was amazing. So you have here the first surgery looks, and then you see 3 months after, it doesn't look the same case. It looks like, you know, it looks like false. And you can see the place of the implant, there was a gap, now there isn't a gap. It's unbelievable. You can see the other side. It's the same photo, but it's not the same guy. And then I put the central implant. When I do locators, even if the person just wants locators, I do it in the canines. Why? Because I want to put at least one implant in the center and two implants in the back, and the canines leave me space. Even if I don't have the vertical space because of the nerve, I can do angulated implants until the canines. So I like that, because some patients after a year or even two, they have money and they say, I want to do the fix, and now you're done because you put it in a position where it's more difficult. So here are the five implants. And the funny thing is, I even had to wear the bone mill around the two first implants from the first surgery, because then you can see the bone mill has a bit of bones, because the multi-unit abutment didn't go in all the way because of the bone around the implant. So you can see here the amazing amount of bone that grown and cover all the spirals in the implant. And you can see here the temporary abutments. You can see here, I put a second layer of Augma. This is my opinion also. I cannot prove that it works, but the idea was to, you know, each time you open a flap, you lose the blood that feeds that bone, and you might lose some bone. And I wanted to gain not only a bit of horizontal bone if possible, because the bleeding, the bone is a baby bone, is still very vital, and the cortical is bleeding. So, and also I wanted to protect from infection, and it helps the healing. So here it's the final aspect with the titanium abutments and the multi-unit abutments. My technician for this surgery cannot come because the laboratory was in COVID alert, and I also didn't want it to come. So I know how to do it. Sometimes I do it. I don't like to do it because it's too messy, but I've done the adaptation from the old plate, or from the old prosthesis to this one. And it looks good. So this is the final x-ray. And I think it was very, very good. I just want to ask you a bit of your time for the last surgery, which I think is also very nice. And then I'll let you go and dine with your families. So this is an image from the even more further than Sagres, you know, the European Western part of Europe that I showed in the other photo. This is the Açores. It's for me one of the most, maybe the most beautiful place I have ever been. And it's just something like heaven. It's beautiful. If you have an opportunity, go to a surge, it's beautiful. So this is a case of, 65 years old woman that she doesn't remember the last time she left without having a bit of, she tries to disguise the laughing. She closed the mouth, and it's even difficult because she had a very exposed gum. You can see the first photo. She's not laughing. She's when she opens her mouth, it shows like that, like this. It's not so ecstatical. Her husband and her make a very nice couple. You know, they're still in love despite the age. So it's impossible not to feel some, love for them also, because they are very nice. And so I wanted, she came and I wanted to go to another place, because it's the kind of case that you don't really want to mess with. You can see the x-ray. It was very, very bad. And now you will see that she didn't have any bone in the back, and she did have all the bone in the world in the front and showing. You can see the photos. She's like, just opening the lips, and you can see almost all the maxilla. And then when she left, a little bit, because she didn't have any, appetite for laughing, she showed me like this. You can see that the old plate was the one that was in the right place. So it helped me a bit to understand where I had to cut it. I make a superposition of the photo, of this photo, and the CBCT, and then I define the part of bone I have to cut to disguise the ending of the future hybrid prosthesis. So this is the intraoral photographs. You can see it looks like Mr. Ed, and it was even worse than the CBCT. So I gave her the all the things I had to do and the prices, and I was hoping she was, oh, it's too expensive, you're a thief, I'm going away, but she didn't. And so she decided to trust me, and I told her I had to do also the bottom. She did, oh, I just want the top. No, it's impossible to do it. So we have to do the top and the bottom at the same time. So here is the dental scan. You can see it on the lateral side. It's amazing. And the amount of bone I had to cut to put the implants, it was, defying a situation. So you can see it here. We begin the surgery. You can see the, I like to extract the teeth before I open it, okay? And I don't know why, I probably had my reason. I don't like it to bleed, maybe, or if I had to do more anesthetic, it will keep the anesthetic there better than if I open it all, because some teeth, they still hurt when you take it out, etc. And so I decided to open the flap after the extraction, and I ask you to take a bit of attention to the palatal tissue and the place where it appears, and then I will show you the amount of bone we had to cut and the distance for the palatal tissue. And so we had pretty much horizontal bone in the front, despite the bone defects. And so I decided to do the implants. I always start with the central in this case. I don't know why I started with the right lateral, but it was okay anyway. I like to put the implants with the hand, as I told you, with the implant driver. And so then I, after the tree in the front, I put the angulated implants in the back, because I had no bone. I had to angulate it like hell. And but normally I like to do it, so there's no problem. You just have to plan it really well. And then you put the implants, and then you put the abutments. They look like normal implants. And the only problem I had then was the lack of bone horizontally in the back implants. So I didn't want to let them, because as you can see here, it was very thin. It was almost the largeness of the implant. So I had to put Augma there, and I knew right now that it will work like hell. So this is a little picture. I'm sorry for the quality of the image, but it was just to show you how I put the Augma. We're putting it on one side. Pressing it for 3 seconds. See, it's very stable. But don't worry if it falls. Sometimes it falls a little. In this case, it was even good because it fell. And then I put it again. I even have a bit more. And it's very good because it comes with a good quantity, with a 1 cc, which is what you need for most of the grafts. Then you press it again, 3 seconds. You take the excess from the gum, and you have the final aspect of the bone graft with bone appetite. And then you see the front sockets, which, as I cut so much, they're only little holes. And because I have to pay, Amos, I have to pay Augma. You know, maybe you'll give me some. And so I had to pay it. Of course, you have to think like, you know, this is surgery and you're paying things, and the patient is paying things also. So I had lots of bone that I cut from the patient. And so I use them with a bone meal. You can see here the Augma. I don't know, I think it was, I don't know if I put a bit more or I don't remember, I think not. And here you can see the bone. I use the bone that I recollect from the earlier when I cut when I did the osteo section and osteotomy. And then I use the little bits of bone with a bone meal, and I get some really little pieces of bone, and I put it in the places because it's autogenous bone, and it's a very good graft also. So I put the coppings that I use for suturing. I just like to say it because I don't want people to think that I do impressions with this lousy coppings, because I don't know who invented it, but it doesn't know anything about surgery. I use them. It was a very good invention to suture because they are larger than the other titanium temporary abutments, and it's very good to do the suturing. A friend of mine called Ernesto Toncatins told me, and it was a very good idea. So I do the suture, I take them out, and then I put the temporary titanium abutments, and I leave the amount of space to take out, and then during the acrylization of the temporary prothesis, I can take it out and put it back in without damaging the tissues or having problems to screw the screws. So then we pass very quickly to the bottom surgery. It's very simple. I did the extractions, the implants, like the other case for the locators, because she didn't want to spend so much money. Now she tells me she is very repentant because she should have done both surgeries with the fixed teeth then, you know, a month and a half ago. But and I know that because she sent me a friend that told me, I want to do both at the same time because my friend is, she's repentant because she didn't. So there was an accident when I take one of the teeth out, and you can see I broke a bit of bone on the vocal side. You can see in the first photo, and then I screw it back in because it was attached to the periosteum. I screw it in place and it will work. So I didn't want to lose any volume there, and it helped for the augma bone appetite to stay there also. And I'm sure I'll have a beautiful result. Suturing, locators, and then the acrylization of the temporary prosthesis. In this case, I had already the lab technician. And here is the post-surgery look. And here it's the healing after 1 week. One more time, it looks very great. We're talking about an old lady. And Here you can see 1 month and a half after, and it looks great. It doesn't look the same person. So, and you can see the volume on the back. I want you to see the volume on the back implants. Okay, so this is the before and after. And that's why I told in the webinars, this is why it's probably the only good thing about being a dentist nowadays and an oral surgeon, whatever. It's the, you will die early, but you'll die happy, because when a patient comes to you and embrace you and cries and say, thank you, thank you, thank you, and her husband and everything, you go home and you think it's, all the things that you pass through. And some days, those patients that come, and you know who they are, it makes you worth it. It makes you worth it. So thank you very much for your attention. And I was very, very happy to do this. And it was a great honor for me, not only the invitation from Amos, but also your presence. And I hope that you enjoyed it, and you might take something for your day-to-day practice. And thank you very much. You have my mail on the bottom. You can ask me whatever you want about the using of the material, okay? Be free to do so. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you so much. Three important notes. You will receive an email with a request to fill in the feedback form. The feedback helps us to create new educational content, so we would appreciate if you would take a minute to respond. If you are a US clinician, you also get a short description of how to claim your CE credit. You can sign up to augmabio.com to watch on-demand webinars, clinical cases from Augma's bone cement experts, including Dr. Ferreira, and scientific literature and research. Currently, we have more than 15 on-demand webinars in English, Spanish, Portuguese, and French. U.S. clinicians who complete a webinar receive a complimentary CE credit. If anyone has follow-up questions, they can also write to us at info@augmabio.com. Thank you so much, Dr. Ferreira.
It was a pleasure. Thank you. Wonderful.